Hosanna, it is Palm Sunday, that peculiar word that appears so often on this day, but rarely anywhere else. Hosanna, deliver us. Hosanna, save us. Hosanna, accompanied in our popular celebration by palm branches, only found in the Gospel of John. Today, we're going to focus on the Gospel of Mark, but as Christians over the centuries, we've put them all together. The triumphal entry into Jerusalem, Jesus riding on a donkey, the palms, the children. What a marvelous celebration of the beginning of this Holy Week. We have a wonderful service planned, especially the music that stirs up in me memories of childhood, because it seemed in a real case that this Sunday is dedicated to children because they led in the celebration of Jesus coming from Bethany into Jerusalem. Hosanna, deliver us. This is a day of a parade, a day of celebration, a day of hope, a day of looking forward as we continue to emerge carefully but steadily from this pandemic, a day that we look forward to gathering at noon today on Palm Sunday, noon to 2. We will have a donkey here to remind us that it is Palm Sunday and distribute palms as well as goodies. It is a time for us to see each other socially distanced, but to see each other. It is the beginning of that emergence for our church. Hosanna, deliver us. And it is also time that we be in prayer and in unity with one another, especially those of the Asian American and Pacific Islander community as they continue to grieve the massacre in Atlanta, Georgia. We have written to our bishop. We have written to Pastor Han, who leads United Methodist congregations here in Madison, to offer our union with them in their grief for those that come from a similar culture. But we are all children of God, all grieving the reality of the violence that is becoming that which defines our culture and our country. Hosanna, deliver us. Hosanna. Let us praise and worship God together in repentance, in pleading, and in hope.
Hosanna, Hosanna. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna. As we observe Palm Sunday and enter into the Holy Week, we give thanks for the mighty grace of God who has offered us salvation through the ministry and mission of Jesus. With songs of thanksgiving, let us sing praises to God. With shouts of hosannas, let us welcome the presence of Jesus. With prayers of blessings, let us call out the Spirit of God. Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord, and blessed are we when we stand with him. Let us praise in our own homes. Join me with shouts of hosannas. Hosanna, Hosanna. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord.
Children sing.
Oh my, oh my, how did you get here? Oh, really, really? You're looking forward to a parade. Well, yes, there'll be a parade. There'll be a parade this afternoon. Yes, yes, it's a parade like the parade Jesus had on Palm Sunday. Yep, that's why there are all of these palms. No, no, it's not an Easter parade. It's a parade before Easter that we call Palm Sunday. It's when Jesus came into Jerusalem before a very difficult week. Oh, you'd like to go to the parade. I'm glad. I'd like you to go with me. We're going to be there. Yes, at noon today, noon to two. And everybody will get a palm, and we will remember that great parade, and we'll greet each other. It's a beautiful spring, and we are looking forward to seeing other people. Are you looking forward to seeing? Yes, yes, I knew you were. Yes, yes, I guess I like your ears. Why are you wearing those ears? Oh, the rabbits at our house. Yes, there are quite a few of them that come around this time of year. Yes, I know. They're all over the house. Have you counted them? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 12. Are there more than 12? Lots more than 12. Rabbits at Easter. Isn't that curious? And lots of rabbits. Do you know why? Oh, the reason is that rabbits were fun to tell the story of Jesus. No, Jesus didn't know very many rabbits. But rabbits in the spring, lots and lots and lots of rabbits, reminds us of how quickly life comes when we follow Jesus, especially at Easter. There's new life. There's exciting life. We celebrate it with parades and with wonderful times together. Oh yes, you also found eggs. Where were the eggs? Yes, they were near the rabbits. No, rabbits don't lay eggs. Eggs and rabbits are not the same, but they mean the same thing at Easter. Eggs, do you know what comes from an egg? Yes, a little chick. And that's why we decorate the eggs at Easter, is the celebration of new birth, like little chicks being born. So rabbits are about life and lots of it all coming at the same time. And eggs, new birth, like lots of little chicks. Okay, after today's parade, we'll go home and decorate the eggs. And you and all your rabbit friends, you can hold those eggs, and we will eat them together at Easter. Oh yes, they don't all need to be chicken eggs. You want chocolate eggs too, don't you? Oh yes, you do. Why is that? Well, yes, there are some of us in the house who like chocolate better than eggs. We'll do it. Happy Easter. And by the way, those are pretty nice ears for a little while. Happy Palm Sunday. Happy Easter.
As we gather now for prayer, let us remember that God's love is constant and devoted to us. May we say that over and over. God's love is unfailing in caring for us through healthcare workers and researchers, through teachers reopening classrooms and therapists available around the clock. And God's love is available for our own family. Dan Wolpert, Shirley Blank, Iris Peterson, Jim Reynolds, Roy Prestige. Justice is the gate God opens to us all, and we say that over and over. God hears the cries of those who are forgotten, those who sleep rough in forgotten streets, those who are most vulnerable around us, those who have no family to care for them, those who are victims of hate, racial violence, those who are victims of gun violence and opioid abuse, all those here and abroad still deprived of the abundant life which Jesus promises to us in our lives, those in the experience of deep and extended grief, those traumatized and re-traumatized. God comes to bring us new life. Let us say that over and over. God takes the stone tossed aside by us to build the foundation of salvation, a foundation made out of grace's gravel, the sand of hope shaken out of Jesus' shoes and mixed with the waters of life. And so, after a year of weariness, we struggle to put one foot in front of the other. If we manage to pull ourselves out of bed each morning, and yet you take us by the hand, steadfast love, as we walk through the streets of your community of grace and wonder, listening to the songbirds. After a year of endless stories of those who refuse to be cautious, who could care less about others, of those who preach fear and hate, who perpetrate power and privilege over people and the priorities of the necessities of life, we try to keep our ears from being stuffed with cotton word of hope for all, so we might too learn how to listen to the hearts which are ignored by everyone everywhere. After a year of staying in place, it is no wonder we want to run away, for the days of exhaustion, the overwhelming worries, the fears that are velcroed to us. So model for us, peace of the weary, how to dare to bear the injustices of those blamed by far too many for these days in which we find ourselves. After a year of struggling to follow Jesus faithfully through the Bethanies, the Bethpages, and the Mount of Olives of our lives, we know how we have worn down others by our angry words, how we have wearied loved ones with poor choices. Yet we also recognize that every moment of every day, God, you have been with us with that love which never gives us up, the grace which is always offered freely to us. We have been so busy this last year, focused on ourselves, enduring love, that we have forgotten to imagine what was on Jesus' mind in those days. We long to shout for joy on a day like this, smiling as we remember waving our palms, even as we look at our empty hands. We harden our faces, not in discipleship, but to turn away those who are still struggling in these days, hiding behind the palms that are the boxwoods. Yet because he was fully human like us, God whose compassion never fades, we can be more like Jesus if we dare. So as we begin our journey through another holy week of worshiping apart, yet strangely more together than we imagine, help us to always choose humility over hubris, weakness over strength, tenderness over bullying, and to seek to stay faithful as we can in these days. You dare us to think like Jesus because you know that if we do, we will find the strength to live through these days, to walk with others, to offer our lives in love and service to all, to spread the compassion of Christ even in the face of fear and hate. God, you hear our prayers, listen to our hearts, and now fill us with forgiveness, and you walk with us in these moments and in all the ones to come. We thank you for such incredible mercy as we now pray thankfully. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Ride on, King Jesus, no man can hinder me. Ride on, King Jesus, ride on, no man can hinder me.
Well, well,
for he is King of Kings, he is the Lord of Lords, Lord Jesus Christ, the first and last, no man works like him.
For he is King of Kings,
Lord. Jesus Christ, the first and last. No man works like him.
Oh, won't you ride on?
But on King Jesus, ride on. No man can hinder him.
King Jesus rides a milk-white horse.
No man works like him.
Oh, Lord, the river of Jordan he did cross.
No man works like him.
For he is King
of Kings.
He is the Lord.
Lord of Lords. Oh, Jesus Christ, the first and last. No man works like him.
King Jesus rides a middle of the air.
No man works like him.
Oh, Lord, he calls the saints from everywhere.
No man works like him. Oh, won't you ride on, King Jesus? No man can hinder me. Ride on, King Jesus, ride on. No man can hinder me.
For he is King
of Kings,
the Lord
of Lords. Oh, Jesus Christ, the first and last. No man works like him. Christ, the first and last, no man works like him.
For he is King,
King of Kings,
the Lord,
Lord of Lords. Oh, Jesus Christ, the first and last, no man works like him.
Good morning on this exciting and blessed day. My name is Isaac Hoffmaster, and today I will be reading Mark 11, verses 1 through 11. When they were approaching Jerusalem at Bethpage and Bethany, near the Mount of Olives, he sent two of his disciples and said to them, "Go into the village ahead of you, and immediately as you enter it, you will find tied there a colt that has never been ridden. Untie it and bring it. If anyone says to you, 'Why are you doing this?' just say this: 'The Lord needs it, and will send it back immediately.'" They went away and found a colt tied near a door outside in the street. As they were untying it, some of the bystanders said to them, "What are you doing untying the colt?" They told them what Jesus had said, and they allowed them to take it. Then they brought the colt to Jesus and threw their cloaks on it, and he sat on it. Many people spread their cloaks on the road, and others spread leafy branches that they had cut in the fields. Then those that went ahead and those that followed were shouting, "Hosanna! Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is the coming kingdom of our ancestor David. Hosanna in the highest heaven." Then he entered Jerusalem and went into the temple. And when he had looked around at everything, as it was already late, he went out to Bethany with the 12. Here ends the lesson from Mark. May it be a lamp to our feet and a light to our path.
Hosanna. It is a rare word in the ancient texts, but it occupies an entire Sunday, all of our hymnody, all that we think or say. Hosanna, that wonderful word. Scholars have wondered where it comes from. Perhaps it was a particular call adopted by the followers of Jesus. They brought it from the countryside of Galilee and repeated it often enough that the children picked up this strange thing that they said, and they wanted to be part of it, and they learned Hosanna as they gathered together there on the hillside of the Mount of Olives. Hosanna, deliver us now. It is both a joy and a plea. It comes deeply out of the heart and the situation and the urgency that we might have, given wherever we might be. But it's also a word of great joy, Hosanna, because there is hope in it that we will be delivered. It's not an empty plea with no meaning. Hosanna, Hosanna. And there they were, the villagers of Bethany and Bethphage, Silwan and Gethsemane. They lived amongst the relics and the shrines and the monuments of that storied range east of Jerusalem, the Mount of Olives. It was here that the prophets stood in the shadow of Mount Zion that rose above them over Jerusalem. The tomb of the great King David was on Mount Zion. They remembered the greatness of the promise of God for the people Israel and therefore all the world. And they stood right here on the Mount of Olives looking at the shrine on Mount Zion to that promise. And they predicted, they foresaw the coming of the Messiah, a Messiah that would deliver the people and fulfill the promise that was from the beginning. Hosanna, Hosanna must have been the response to the retelling of that story as Jesus and his disciples came from the Galilee in Mark for the first time to visit Jerusalem. Hosanna. And I picture in my sanctified imagination that the little children stayed out a little too late and they listened as the call and response of the story and the Hosanna, and they picked that up, that this must be a story of great joy. And the idea that it took place in their little villages that were on the margins now of Jerusalem, the margins in places like Bethany, the house of the forgotten poor, Bethpug, the house of unripened fruit, the margins, that here was where the prophet stood. Here is where the Messiah will come. Here becomes the focus of this day. Hosanna, the little children sang. If we look through the Mount of Olives, what struck me when I first went there and must have struck Jesus and the disciples is that this place, although there is a great olive grove over in Gethsemane where there is an olive press, there below Bethany and Bethpug, there's a massive necropolis, a graveyard. This is where the servants of the great monarchs of Israel were buried. Those who could not have a place of honor underneath the palace came to the Mount of Olives, and so there they were. Reminds us of the importance of service within the Christian church and in the ministry and the mission of Christ. And here they are. The servants are buried there. The tradition grew that the Messiah who would come to this place as was prophesied by the great prophets of the Old Testament, Zechariah and Zephaniah, others who basically said, will come here to the Mount of Olives and raise the dead and judge them righteous. Death is not an end, but that there is something beyond. The life that God has created and brought forth on this earth is not for a season. But there is some sense in the faith community of Israel, the faith community that is now Christianity, and in many different ways, the faith communities throughout the earth and throughout history, that there is something beyond this season in which we live. And there are those who sought to be buried on the Mount of Olives so that when the Messiah came, they would be the first ones raised and judged righteous and be eternally as part of the household of Israel. When I stood there personally for the first time, it must have struck me in some way in the memory that the disciples also had, that as they stood in those necropolis, graveyards, the amount of hope in a future life that was invested in those who came to be buried there, not that they would rest there for eternity, but in being raised to new life, the eternal promises of God for us all. there on the Mount of Olives. That too is the promise. In this year when we've experienced so much death and so much sickness, when the world has been locked down and kept in, the idea that there is this hope amongst us that begins, it seems to me, in the breaking forth of spring, the promise that we walked this journey on Ash Wednesday when there was nothing here but thorns. And now, the beauty of the green that is emerging all around us, a hope for a new spring, that we will emerge from our houses and from the cave mentality that many of our doctors are worried about, that we've been inside so long that we will be afraid to come out. And those that we have lost, that we have not been able to thoroughly celebrate their lives, the hope of their faith, and to be together and to give God thanks for what they have done for us. But we gather here on the Mount of Olives in this graveyard, a graveyard that, yes, marks the death of those who are buried in this place. But more importantly, the hope that will be fulfilled at Easter, and that when Jesus rode that donkey down the Mount of Olives and toward Jerusalem, was riding through the grief of the graveyard, but the hope that was set before him. Here we are, the Mount of Olives, the place of hope in the midst of death, the place of promise in the midst of despair, the place where the Messiah would come. And it's said that when the Messiah came, not only would the dead be raised and hope be infused in the people, but there would be a great earthquake here on the Mount of Olives, this great defensive ridge that protected Jerusalem from all armies and enemies that would assault it from the east. And the Mount of Olives itself would be cracked and fall apart because no defense against another would ever be needed again. The beginning of that ride, the beginning of Jesus' entry into Jerusalem, is the beginning of the fulfillment of the promise that no longer would we need defense, no longer would we need violence, but that the future of the earth is a future of peace, to build each other up, to join each other together. Mark wanted to make sure that we understood that Jesus, this Jesus of Nazareth, that had come with his disciples to this place, in fact, was the Messiah. And tells this quirky little story about the fact that here they have been walking for days and days to come from the Galilee down to Jerusalem for the gathering of the Passover. They couldn't afford to stay in the city in the protection of the wall, so they stayed there in Bethany. And Jesus said to his disciples the next day, "We need to get into the city." Any reasonable person would have said, "Well, just walk there. This is a pretty steep hill. We can walk down and then walk up." Oh, no. You go to the next town, and you'll find a colt there, tethered to a tree. Take it. Bring it here. Well, the disciples were a little shocked. What do we do? You're asking us basically to go into the next town and steal an animal. An animal who is basically necessary for the economy of that family, if not that entire village. Oh no. Tell them the Lord has need of it. Oh, when I was a child, I was transfixed by that story. I knew who Jesus was, even as a little child. Everybody knows who Jesus is. So, of course, people would say, "I should have known it was Jesus. Go ahead, take the colt." But in the middle of this poverty, in the middle of this despair, in the middle of the violence that is represented by the Roman Empire coming into Jerusalem a few days before with their great legions, the greatest human weapon in the world, to take over the holy city of Jerusalem. And Pontius Pilate would sit there in Antonia Fortress, a Roman presiding over the Passover with power and repression and might. All of that was present and heavy and weighted there on the Mount of Olives. And this small little request, the Lord has need of your donkey, I don't believe in the day impressed anyone. Which is the amazing part of the story. They gave it. They let it be borrowed for this impromptu parade that was forming itself there on the Mount of Olives. And Jesus, who had just walked with his 12 all the way from the Galilee here to the Mount of Olives, got on top of that donkey, that royal presence, and started down the steep slope along the paving stones of the Roman road. It's clear that the donkey was probably beginning to slip, that it was not prepared for this parade. And so people threw their cloaks onto the ground. Jesus had asked to borrow cloaks throughout his life. If you have one, give it to one who has need. And here is this monarch who has the need of the people, the simple people, the people who lived in the villages, the people who would never be invited into Jerusalem to celebrate the Passover, the servants and the poor. They put their cloaks on the road. And the children, all wanting to be a part of this, they went into the fields, according to Mark, and they cut scrub and boxwood, and they threw it down on the road so it would guarantee further that the donkey would not slip. This is not the grand entrance that we see in the gospel according to John that is filled with the royal palms and the magisterial Jesus who is about ready to enter the royal city or the holy city of Jerusalem and take his royal place in the temple. Oh no, this is an impromptu parade that no one in Jerusalem even cared about. There is nothing that the Romans record about this day. It doesn't even appear to be a challenge to them. At the end of this story, we see when Jesus arrives in Jerusalem, he's even lost the people who gathered around with the cloaks and the boxwood. It seems that he and the 12 are the only ones who go into the temple itself, and instead of taking the temple as the one who is our leader, the one who has finally come to be the Messiah, the one who will deliver us, he looks around quickly and then leaves back to the Mount of Olives. It is a curious story. The more I thought about it, prayed about it, tried to imagine, it is a comforting story. It's not about the triumph in the temple. It's about who came to be part of this parade. Jesus, in this impromptu moment, has gathered children. Jesus has gathered the grieving. Jesus has gathered those who know that what is going on in Jerusalem amongst the religious elite is that they will do anything to keep their power, anything to placate Rome. And therefore, the Passover itself no longer has any meaning, and nor does the promise. And they weep. They weep about the status of the world in which they live. And then there are those that I imagine gathered there. The woman who was at the well gathered there. The paralytic who was healed gathered there. The lost and the blind and the lame gathered there. Nicodemus came out of the city by the dark of night and gathered there. You and I have gathered there. Oscar Romero, whose feast day we celebrated this week, the martyr of El Salvador, the one who called us back to Jesus' primary effort to care for the poor and was murdered in the cathedral in San Salvador, he gathered there. Cesar Chavez saw the plight of the farm workers. He gathered there. The families of those who have been murdered in Atlanta and all those who fear because they are Asians living in this country, they have gathered there. And those from Boulder, Colorado, who thought that they lived in a protective bubble, and when they talked about it, it sounded much like Madison, a bubble of protection. And that bubble has been shattered. They, too, have gathered there. And here on the Mount of Olives, on this hillside, we weep for the world in which we live, and we find these peculiar words ushering forth from the depths of our soul, Hosanna, Hosanna, deliver us now. We see the graves of those who have died, those who have been killed, those who during the pandemic were all by themselves, those who have struggled, those who have overcome. But there must be hope. There must be life beyond the terror and the horror that we experience. And so, coming out of our yearning to fulfill the promises that Jesus gave to us, we yell, Hosanna, Hosanna, deliver us now. And those little children, the ones who found the delight in joining in this parade with a donkey and boxwood, and these peculiar ones that came from the Galilee and told us stories. Stories they probably didn't remember. But can't you see them running after each other, coming to pat the donkey, to shake the hands of those strangers who had come to join the parade out of their little village and attempt to go closer to the great city that they had been told to stay out of? Hosanna, Hosanna, isn't this wonderful? Hope out of despair. Joy in the midst of weeping. A new spring, a new hope. A new possibility. Summer is coming. A new life. This will be filled with people. And I pray we don't go back to a normal of despair, a normal of violence, a normal of disparity, a normal of hatred amongst the people of God. But this newness is the newness that Jesus promised in his life and assured in his resurrection, and that these days that are ahead of us, difficult as they might be, careful as we may need to be, cautious as we must be, are filled with a joy where all the peoples of the earth recognize the horror of the despair that we have been through, of the threat to our life on this planet, and that we recognize our need to reach out to one another and comfort each other in our grief, build one another up in our weakness, and hope for the children of the world that all of them, may enjoy the riches of what God has bestowed upon us, all of God's children. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna. Amen.
Streets. There in the distance they begin to see, riding on a donkey comes the Son of God.
From every corner a thousand voices sing, praises to him who comes in the name of God. With one great shout of acclamation loud, triumphant song breaks forth. Praises to him who comes in the name of God. With one great shout of acclamation loud, triumphant song breaks forth.
Hosanna, Hosanna to the King.
We are thankful to God, and we are thankful to you. God has given us blessings beyond measure, hearts of mercy, hands of grace, and the presence of Jesus among us, in our souls and in our lives. We can never repay what we have received, but we trust that God will help us carry it forward. May we use the gifts of hearts and hands to sustain the weary in word and in deed. May we be awakened to all who long for God's peace and have courage enough to walk with them. May the gifts and offerings we bring this morning reflect our gratitude for Jesus' gift of self, for Jesus' anguish and passion, and for Jesus' never-failing love. Thank you for supporting the ministry of First United Methodist Church. Your gifts make a great difference. And may God bless you. Thank you.
Children, raise sweet hosannas ring.
Our service is now ended. So now we will set aside our palm branches to go and serve at God's side in a broken and fearful world. Now we will pick up our cloaks and follow Jesus wherever he leads, even the road to the garden and the cross beyond, to learn from those the world ignores, to be touched by the grace within them. Now we will sing songs of wonder as we work alongside the Spirit, sustaining the weary with peace and hope. May God's peace and hope and the blessing of the triune God be with us today as we go through Holy Week. Carry us into Easter and forevermore. Amen.
Last night I lay asleeping, there came a dream so fair. I stood in old Jerusalem beside the temple there. I heard the children singing, and ever as they sang, methought the voice of angels from heaven in answer rang. Methought the voice of angels from heaven in answer rang. Jerusalem, Jerusalem, no longer rang. Hushed were the glad hosannas, the little children sang. The sun grew dark with mystery, the morn was cold and chill, as the shadow of a cross arose upon a lonely hill. As the shadow
away. It was the new Jerusalem, Jerusalem, lift up your gates and sing. Hosanna in the highest, Hosanna forevermore. Hosanna in the highest, Hosanna forevermore.
Hi, I'm Bobby Fouch Reynolds. I'm a volunteer in the communications office here at First Church, and we're glad you're here. We're eager to hear from you, so if you have comments, questions, or suggestions about our virtual offerings, please contact me at bobby@fumc.org. Or if you'd like to know more about our other offerings at First Church, just contact us and we'll get back to you. Thanks for being here. God bless.